Export settings are an important but often ignored technical topic that animators should be familiar with, especially for freelance and personal animations. The way you export your animation affects how good or bad it looks on social media, the file size, frame rate, dimensions, transparency, audio quality, compatibility, and how much image quality gets ruined when reusing the clip. By the end of this tutorial, you'll be able to pick the best settings for your specific program and situation, whether it's uploading videos to YouTube, creating videos that have transparent backgrounds, or selling animated video clips as commissions. If you already know all your stuff and just want the quote-unquote best settings, those are on screen now. These are PC and Mac friendly with a great balance of quality versus file size. For everyone else, let's move on to the tutorial that makes sense of all this. Most of the time, your finished animation is a video file. Videos have two parts, a container and a codec. The container you already recognize, it shows up at the end of the file itself. You'll probably use MP4 or MOV. The container doesn't really matter, it's the codec that matters. The codec reads and writes your video data, it controls pretty much everything. Some codecs are meant for high quality archival video, some are low quality, meant for watching, streaming, uploading, and some are intermediate, meant for video editing. If you understand the difference between a PNG and a JPEG image, codecs are like that for video. So if I take a video clip, export it, use that new file, export that, and so on and so on, the video will rapidly lose quality depending on the codec. Some codecs are lossless and lose no quality at all. If you've participated in an animation collaboration and noticed your animation looks worse in the final project, it's because you used a lossy codec, and then the organizer used a lossy codec, and then YouTube compressed it again. So why not use lossless codecs all the time? Because of compatibility issues and huge file sizes. We're talking 120 gigabyte files or bigger per video. Media players will lag when trying to play these codecs, or they won't recognize the codec at all, and your video will appear as a black screen, unless you drop it into a professional video editing program. Choosing codec settings is always a balance between quality and file size. Here's a chart to help you decide what type of codec you want to use. While you're working on a project, use a lossless or intermediate codec for all clips and effects you export for future reuse. When you export the final video, choose a lossy codec with more compression. In most cases, the cheaper your animation program, the less export options you'll have. Some apps may not give you any choices at all. You'll click an export button, and what you get is what you get, probably with the company's logo on top of your art. Let's move on to the specifics of turning raw animation into video. Here we are with our finished animation. Toon Boom, After Effects, Premiere, whatever you're using, TV Paint, it doesn't matter. Understand that the settings in your animation program, the settings on your timeline, are not the same as the settings that pop up on export. Just because you set the frame rate at 24 here doesn't mean it will be 24 here, though most programs by default try to match the two for you. Because of this, make sure before you start drawing that your canvas size matches or is proportionally bigger than what you want the final video to be. If you're drawing at 1920 by 1080, but exporting to 3840 by 2160 on a 4K monitor, the art will be blurry because it's been upscaled. Resizing bigger is not great. No resizing at all or resizing smaller is usually what you want to be doing. So because of all this, be aware of what your animation project settings are, especially frame rate, because you want them to match your export settings. As a first example, I'm going to export from Toon Boom, export movie. You need QuickTime installed to get the move container option to show, and also to use ProRes in general. So just, yeah, get that installed. Standard MP4 H.264 is your other option. WMV is archaic. Who even uses that anymore? I'm using Toon Boom Advanced, which is like not the most expensive version, so just know that this has limitations because you don't get any options with the MP4 container. That's it, this is what you get. Export. In Toon Boom, the Move container has more flexibility. Click Movie Options, and then here are your codec choices. If this is your final animation and you're not going to be putting clips together in other programs to do more stuff, choose a lossy codec. Max out all the settings. You only need to decrease the settings if you're trying to get under a file size limit for social media. On the other hand, if you plan to edit this clip somewhere else, choose a lossless or intermediate codec and max out the settings. When you're doing exporting, whenever you see in your color options a plus or with alpha channel, that means your video can have transparency. An alpha channel is way better than green screening. Every animator should know about alpha channels because it's insanely useful. So that's what exporting from an animation program looks like. Now let's export from a video editing program. This is where you get all of the options, and I'll be able to explain the picky details. I'm using Adobe Premiere and Adobe Media Encoder. Other programs will have similar options, organized differently, sometimes with different labels, but it's basically all the same stuff. Here's an animation made of clips that have already been exported from Toon Boom in a lossless format. The great thing about pre-exported clips is render time goes down by hours. And when you review the finished animation, if there are render errors or mistakes, you only need to fix that section and drop it in, rather than export the entire raw project and hope your computer doesn't crash. At this stage, you're normally exporting a final video, so you'll choose a lossy codec that shrinks down the file size and is compatible on all media players. If your video is going to be uploaded on a social media site, look up their recommended settings, because that's what you want to be using. Otherwise, for a general final video, I suggest the H.264 codec. Inside that codec, there are many options, but the only new thing we need to understand is bitrate. Think of bitrate as a quality slider. You can find charts online to choose bitrate based on your video dimensions and frame rate. I use 40 for 4K and 10 for 1080p. If you want to have a teeny tiny file size, you can put bitrate way down. This is useful for making video clips to direct upload on social media. When you export a video, you also choose audio quality settings. You can lower audio bitrate to shrink file size as well, though I don't recommend it. Choosing a lossless or intermediate codec usually eliminates the bitrate or quality slider because little to nothing is being compressed. Other than that, settings should be left to default. You want variable bitrate, not constant bitrate. The other options are mostly there for video files that will be broadcasted on cable or satellite TV, and if you're doing that kind of work, the station will have a guideline that tells you what options to pick. Though for cable, they're probably not going to want H.264, they're probably going to want something like MPEG. Just follow the guidelines. A couple of option boxes on my screen are Adobe specific. If you use Premiere, there are tutorials made by other artists on how to optimize your workflow and get your render time down to only a few minutes. Definitely worth researching, and I wish I had done it sooner, because having a Scribble Kibble episode crash is a pain in the butt. If you're super ambitious, you can even download third-party open source codecs and use those. Lagarith Lossless is a great example of that. Now that you know all of this, you may be wondering if you're commissioned for an animation, shouldn't you send the client the uncompressed lossless video export? And the answer to that is no. Most people who hire you want a playable video they can upload somewhere, not a 60 gigabyte monstrosity that will only work in VLC Media Player and stutter the whole way through. There's a good chance your client won't even know what a codec is, and asking them what they want will just confuse them. So you're the artist, you're in charge of understanding all this stuff. Now granted, this is for an average freelance job. If you're doing pro work for a studio, TV producer, video editor, yada yada, they're more likely to ask for a lossless export, and they will hopefully give you the specs that they want for the file type they need. In which case, follow that! Here are my best settings for animators as of 2021 again. If you have different favorites, post them in the comments below, especially because standards change over time, and we all like to be educated on this stuff. Some people prefer Cineform and DNxHR, but I find ProRes is more widely supported and easier to use right now, especially for newcomers to this whole codec encoding compression thing. For more animation tutorials, see my tutorial playlist or go to scribblekibble.com.